It's definitely been a welcome turnaround. Seeing us play in the late game on the second day is nice.
Yeah, let's just say I got to chant "We're number four" two times. So.
Sure. Yep.
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA with your host, Tim Brown, Rob Gilreath, Dustin Lindstrom, and
Welcome
Matt Cavender.
Episode 14 of Season 3 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide. I'm Tim Brown, your host, and I'm joined this week by Dustin Lindstrom.
Hey, everyone.
Rob Gilreath.
Hey, guys.
And Matt Cavender.
Hello, everybody.
Our special guest this week is the athletic director of Michigan Tech, Dr. Suzanne Sanregret. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me, and happy holidays to everybody.
Oh.
Yeah, you as well.
This week, we'll talk with Dr. Sanregret about Michigan Tech hockey, the athletic department. I'm sure, guaranteed we'll talk about the GLI, and we'll see where else we go with this. Then we'll try and cover... preview the GLI and do our... Dustin, did you prepare trivia or the hockey challenge?
No, I think we're going to pause it for a little bit because I think there's a lot of uncertainty in whether or not games are going to be played or not in the near future. So
that's true. Maybe we don't need to be picking games and then find out that a whole tournament didn't happen. So
right, okay. That's what I'm worried about. So I think we'll try to ramp it back up again in January.
All right. Let's do the thank you notes plus a brief note from our sponsor, and we'll be back to talk to Dr. Susan Sanregret about Michigan Tech hockey.
Fibke Dental is a general dentistry practice located in downtown Rhinelander, Wisconsin, home of the Hodag. Look online at FibkeDental.com or find them on Facebook. They do pain-free dentistry for kids, adults, people that went to great schools, and people that ended up at Northern Michigan. Stop in and say hi between 8 and 5 and tell them THG sent you. That is F-I-E-B-K-E dental.com.
Hey, it's Kaylee Cuoco for Priceline. Ready to go to your happy place for a happy price? Well, why didn't you say so? Just download the Priceline app right now and save up to 60% on hotels. So whether it's Cousin Kevin's Kazoo Concert in Kansas City, go Kevin! Or Becky's Bachelorette Bash in Bermuda, you never have to miss a trip ever again. So download the Priceline app today. Your savings are waiting.
Go to your happy place for a happy price. Go to your happy price, Priceline.
Welcome back. Let's get right into the fun question. Dave Ellis wants to know why you refused to sway during the Copper Country Anthem.
I only refuse to sway when he is singing it and forcing me to sway with him on a TV6 interview because he can't sing and he has no rhythm and he's offbeat. I except with Dave. It was one time on TV, and I was just like, this can't end soon enough. So, no, Dave, it's a longstanding joke between the two of us. I'm Copper Country born and raised. That's like a theme song. So no worries when I'm at games. My suite, we break with whatever we're doing. So our suite will do the tradition. And it's a big part of Tech hockey, and I continue it on. It's just not with Dave Ellis. So longstanding joke between the two of us.
That's good.
And I'm glad you asked so I could
Just so you know, you're not the only one that has gotten yelled at for not following a Michigan Tech tradition recently. Apparently Rob's dad saw me not stand up for the fight song during the St. Thomas series because I was complaining away to somebody about how things were going in the third period, I believe. So I definitely stood up the next time and did my fist pumps right at, Bob. So, and he wasn't standing, so I don't know what he's talking about.
Well, he had a camera in his hand.
Maybe the old people side is somehow exempt from that, but, that's what I get for sitting like two seats away from the misfits too.
Bob is certainly, one that's going to get the whole section, even on the old people side to get up and do the tradition. So
yeah,
really enjoy your dad. He's a fabric of our athletic programs, and if I don't see him, I'm worried about what's going on at any event. So
yep. Yeah, there's a reason why I'm at a work event in Madison and I'm still here talking about Tech hockey, right? It's a grain in the family. So the acorn didn't fall too far from the tree there.
Yeah. Well, it's good to see your mom and dad back out at events for sure.
Yep. Yeah, I know he's they were worried about being cooped up for a while there now, so I'm glad to see him back too.
Good.
Both basketball and hockey, so I don't know how he can handle not going to the basketball games and the hockey games at the same time. It was a bit bit much.
I stole your dad $20 for upcycling all his old Tech sweatshirts to me, so I got to be sure to get back to the Copper Country and get that back to him.
he definitely likes the triple header days.
Yeah, yep. When you get two basketball games and an Ambo visit, then back to the hockey game, those are good days.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
Yep. For sure.
Well, we might as well get right into the big question that we got asked many times by our listeners. The GLI is not a tournament this year. How and why did we arrive at this GLI showcase format for 2021?
Yeah, good question. One that I fielded for the last 6 months. in the grocery store, at the gas station, at the rink, everywhere. But about 9 months ago, Little Caesars Organization and Olympia Entertainment and 313 Entertainment reached out and asked if we could postpone the traditional GLI again. They are still reeling from a lot of the COVID impact of, you know, so many events canceled and a variety of concerts and things that they had deposits on, and wanting to make the most of every event that they have in Little Caesars Arena. We are partners with the Little Caesars Group as well as Michigan and Michigan State. And it was important to us as a group of three, meaning the three hosts of the tournament, to work with them and be good partners and understand their situations. So we agreed to postpone the traditional format, and instead of fully canceling the GLI games and canceling, I think, some important games to Michigan Tech by playing Michigan and Michigan State, we decided to host them in a showcase format. And we wanted to host them in a location where we were pretty sure that the events could happen without a lot of interference from other events. Meaning, if you go to another venue, do they have concerts? How much are you paying? What if COVID is still ongoing? So arriving at playing at Yost and Munn was a decision we made as a group of three to get the games in. And, you know, I feel really good about our following and the attendance that we will have at both Michigan and Michigan State's games. And from, you know, obviously we would much prefer to be in Little Caesars Arena and be able to play in that venue and be at a neutral site. But there are certainly some positives about playing at Yost and Munn and the pairwise and whatnot. Beating a team in their, you know, considered an away game versus a neutral site could be very beneficial to us. And again, we just wanted to make sure we could get those games on our schedule. The three institutions, meaning Michigan Tech, Michigan State, and Michigan, are working very hard to bring back the GLI in the traditional format. We are certainly still working with Little Caesars Arena on the games being there. And we are still are looking at other neutral sites as a potential backup for maybe one of the dates, but more to come on that as we work through it. And I think it's important to note that, you know, we all, you know, Little Caesars Arena is operated much, much different than Joe Louis ever was. The cost to operate Joe Louis were significantly less. And I think post-COVID and post-Joe Louis, Little Caesars is having to rethink some of the things that they do and how they operate. So there's a variety of things that came to play with the request for us to postpone 1 year. And we're just trying to be really good partners in the situation we're in and working towards a good solution for future years. And I don't want anyone to think that the GLI is dead. We're all three institutions are committed to it. We just have to find something that works for all of us.
So was something like playing at Van Andel in Grand Rapids something you looked at for this year, or was it too late at this point, like when decisions were being made?
It was discussed, but there was still a lot up in the air about the commitment based on COVID and just concern about, yes, the late notice, because it was, we had maybe eight months planning time. And I think that we were all in the throes of COVID and managing the seasons we were in, and managing what this next year would look like, that we just felt it was a safe decision and a good decision to move to this year. And there, you know, the other things that have changed too with Little Caesars, and one thing I want to put out there is how incredible our fans are and how important Michigan Tech hockey is to our alumni and our alumni base, that our attendance certainly has grown over the years. I think it has come with the success that we've had in our program and the success we've had recently at the tournament. So I commend, you know, our fans for being there. And I think that there's been a drop off of fans maybe from Michigan and Michigan State because of bowl games and basketball games that they have going on. The other thing that I should mention, moving to Little Caesars Arena and their operation and their operation costs, they are really adamant that we play the semifinal on the 30th with the championship on the 31st. And the 31st is problematic in trying to have a triple header in that venue, with the third place game starting at, you know, early afternoon, the championship GLI game a little later, and then following it up with the Red Wings game. And two institutions, our two partners in the GLI, were not really excited about playing that third place game at noon or one. I can't remember if it's noon or one. And they said it was a terrible experience, and tongue in cheek, but I guess I never knew what that
play was. Better.
I never knew what that felt like, because we were always in the championship game for all of those years, which was really great. But, you know, their coaches were concerned about it and didn't think it was the greatest of experiences to, you know, have a premier tournament playing that early in the day. But that was the only way Little Caesars would do it because of their financial operation. You know, they wanted that triple header, and we had to guarantee how many hours before, you know, the 7:30 start for the Red Wings. So there were some logistical issues on the 31st. So we're exploring a lot of options and making some headway and progress, and hope to have something announced, you know, in the spring after this conclusion of this season. So
they could have played after the Red Wings game. That third place game could have been starting at midnight.
Right now they could play with no problems, looks like, with the Red Wings being on pause and the NHL is looking like it's going to be on pause through the new year. Right. So it looks like this might have all been for naught to begin with, which is unfortunate, but that's just kind of the lay of the land, because you know somebody's out there thinking, well, now the building's empty, why not just move the tournament? But, you know, there's obviously logistical problems with the way that it's been set up now.
Yeah, and, you know, there's a variety of things impacting it, and I'm in constant communication with Little Caesars staff that we work with, and, you know, they're having a lot of issues, not just with the COVID pieces, but with staffing and a variety of things. So it's challenging times for sure, and but we found the best solution we could, and we just wanted to make sure we get the games in, and hopefully it really helps us in the pairwise and with strength of schedule, and we get two wins and it boosts our numbers. So I'm going to look at it very positively. I wish it was the tournament format, but there's a lot of positive things that could come out of it for Michigan Tech hockey.
And it's safe to say that as of now, the future plan is to try to return to the traditional tournament format at a neutral site.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay, good.
And there's support with Michigan and Michigan State. And I did see a few of the questions, you know, why does Michigan and Michigan State think this is their tournament? Well, yes, we started it, but they are co-hosts. It is now Michigan Tech, Michigan State, and Michigan. We are the three hosts of the tournament. We have equal shares. We contribute in the decision making, and then we have an invite team, which, as you know, we rotate through other institutions.
So the phrasing of the three of you being hosts. So how come one of the hosts can't have their pep band at the games this year?
The other hot topic. So it's a Big Ten, Big Ten rule. And
I continue to ruin college hockey.
good point. And it was certainly discussed, and both institutions felt that they would prefer not. Blizzard is attending, and the department has purchased tickets so that at least some of our band members can attend, so they can attend and be loud and proud, and just not with instruments, unfortunately. I would guess. I'm not in their administrations, not privy to their conversations, but my guess would be that it would be pretty embarrassing if the visiting team had a band there and the home team did not. And with their bowl games and with basketball games and whatnot going on, they may have an issue with fielding enough band members to play. So my guess would be that was a strategic decision. I don't know for sure, but if I were in their shoes, I would probably be thinking that way.
Well, hopefully we embarrass them on the ice and it won't matter.
I'm sure the pep band folks that will be in attendance will treat this as an opportunity to be as loud as possible anyways. And it'll be just like standing at the breaks at Northern now, where, you know, the whole Misfits section stands at the breaks because they were told that's the only time they could, you know, and it's become a tradition.
Yeah.
You know, years after. So there will be good that comes of it, I think. And it'll be a story that's told for years of why we couldn't be there and how we were annoying because we weren't allowed to take our instruments anyways. So
I agree. And yeah, I get why there's all sorts of, you know, logistical problems this year, but that's just frustrating to me because it's just being involved with Michigan Tech hockey for so long. I just feel like this is like, I understand where you're coming from, where if they're not going to have a band, it's going to look silly if we bring ours and start to run them out of the building. But it just feels like something that we wouldn't do. I feel like if we were hosting this tournament at the MAC and another school approached us about bringing their band, we'd be gung-ho about having them. So it feels a little underhanded to me, especially since Tech is one of the host institutions. So I understand that the Big Ten has their rules, their stipulations, that they don't want to be running out of their own buildings, but it just feels wrong to me.
We all agree, Matt. I mean,
I know.
Yeah, agreed. But I guarantee you the folks that are going to be there in person are going to make the opportunity to be as loud and annoying as possible without instruments to make up for the fact that they're not allowed to be there officially with their instruments, right? So,
oh, trust me, I'm one of them. I'll be doing my part, but it's
yeah, I'm on vacation. I don't know if I'm going to drive around yet, but the quick trip thing in Milwaukee is the same couple of days, and that's only an hour and a half for me to watch college hockey. So I don't know if I'm going to make the drive all the way down yet. We'll see.
You know, Matt, you bring up a really good point, and I'm glad you recognized it. I think that Michigan Tech, in all that we do, Michigan Tech Athletics, and all of that we do, we try to be really inclusive. And I think that it includes inclusivity of our opponents. And you see that camaraderie amongst our band with, you know, Ferris State's band, let's say at the volleyball regional championship that I was just at. You see it many times when we, you know, we played at Ferris and our band was there and they joined Ferris. And it's just, it's the nature of how we operate and how we do things. And I'm really proud of it. And occasionally we don't get the reciprocal, I guess, welcome. And it's unfortunate, but we keep doing what we do best, and that's including everybody. And I feel really strongly about that with how all of our athletic events are conducted between the Misfits, the band, our student section, the cheer team and the stunt team, and, you know, name it, Little Huskies, and all the things that we do. So I'm glad you recognize that. And we certainly will continue to do that. And hopefully it's an example.
Yeah, and I'm really happy that we continue to set that inclusive example, because it even comes down to things where, like, the Misfits aren't allowed to have flags at Northern, but I've seen the Northern kids come with their flags and nobody cares. I like that they do. I think it's cool that they bring another point of contention and kind of help drive the crowd up. I wish more people were like that. So I guess all there really is to do there is set the example and hope others follow.
Yep.
So will you be down at the games for GLI or whatever we want to call it?
You know, at I know everyone's still calling it GLI. We're still calling it the GLI. I actually am going to miss the GLI for the first time in 27 years. My father passed away a couple months ago, and I'm going to stay here with my mom. Once the holidays are over, I think it's going to be a kind of a tough time. So personal note, we don't need to talk further about it, but that is why I'm not going. And it seems like a good year for me to be with her and, you know, kind of handle some of the things that we're missing this year because my dad passed, which is hard because he was the biggest Tech hockey fan ever. And it's hard seeing his seat empty this season. And but yeah, so that's my plan. And I'll be watching and cheering from afar. So
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, sorry to hear.
I should have told you that question off limits, but
I've actually never been to GLI myself. I've never gone to Detroit for it because it's the only time Tech hockey traditionally has been on TV, right? So it was never a reason to travel for us. I think my parents have only gone once themselves, right? It's never an event for us to travel to, even though we've been all over the place for events. And my dad's, you know, as you're aware, my dad has driven to the middle of nowhere for basketball games over the years, but they've only been to GLI once themselves as well because it's a time to be at home with family, and it's why it makes it such a good event for the downstate alums, right? And the downstate folks, they get a chance to go spend time around a Tech event and carry on a family tradition of watching Tech hockey with their family locally over the holidays. And we've never traveled because it's a time to sit at home and actually watch Tech hockey on TV because it's there on TV to watch usually. So yeah, I've never actually been to GLI. I've never been to Detroit for Tech hockey. And I know my parents have only been, I think, only once. They've been only one time.
Yeah, this will be the first time in, I think, 25 or 26 years that I've missed. So, yeah, and I debated a long time about it, but I just felt family's first, and that's what I need to do. So,
yep, I know that's one of the reasons why Matt is with us, right? GLI is what drove you to Tech in the end, right?
Yeah, I lived in the Metro Detroit area until I was about 7. And GLI was like the first hockey event I was taken to. One way I was like, you know, football size. I got taken to my first hockey game, and it was the GLI. And I started off life as a Michigan State fan because my uncle was a football player at Michigan State. He actually had his picture on the cover of Sports Illustrated. But just like going to GLI every year, I was just always so drawn to the Tech fans and their energy. It was just seemed like, no matter what the score was, and I've seen Tech get blown out by some pretty awful scores, they were just always there to support. And it was just like, it was a really cool thing to experience, and it drew me in. And I just started, I didn't cheer for any other team after that. So when I finally got to be there in 2012 to see Tech win the GLI for the first time since 1980, I was just like, I was a puddle of tears. It was great.
Matt, you and me both.
it was so good.
Well, Rob, you've seen as many wins at the GLI as I have in person, and I've gone a couple times.
Yeah. Right. Well, it's like, you know, each time you hear John Scott talk about the GLI, right? You know, he talks about he went for 4 years. He never won a game.
Yeah.
You know, there's been some rough years at the GLI. So our recent experiences have definitely been a welcome turnaround. Seeing us play in the late game on the second day is nice.
Yeah, let's just say I got to chant "We're number four" two times. So
sure. Yep.
My most memorable GLI experience was not at the GLI, but it was with Tim, where we went to a bar to watch the championship game.
Oh yeah,
that one. Finally in a championship game. And it was the one that went to double overtime against Michigan. So we went to the bar, you know, and we ended up being there like an extra 2 hours. And we had convinced them to put this random college hockey game on the TV.
And then second overtime started and the feed cut out.
Oh, yeah.
The feed just stopped working at the start of the second overtime. And we're like, what's going on? What happened to the game? And then it came back on like a minute before Pete Rulo hit the pipe, only to have it go down the other end and whoever score right away.
Mm-hmm.
Was it you, me, and Beth Lynn?
No, I thought it was just the two of us.
Maybe. I thought it was more than just you and me, but yeah. That was a good memory till the very end.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what GLI does. It drives a lot of those types of memories, either whether like it's with family, with friends, whatever. It makes for a holiday get together, and I'm glad to hear it. Hopefully, will go back to its normal tournament format, and maybe some of the fears that people have around it don't need to worry about it. It's just this year. It'll be back to normal next year.
I know I might be speaking as a weird family, but GLI to my family, like as our unit, is more important than Christmas and New Year. Like that's our thing. And that's not an exaggeration. We look forward to it all year. Right around Thanksgiving, we start planning for it.
That's awesome.
So speaking of it being a big event, are there some alumni gatherings? Like where can I get a pickled egg this year?
Actually, I don't know if they'll have pickled eggs, but there is an alumni gathering pre-game at both locations. I don't remember the bars. They're on the alumni MTU okay. alumni page, but I believe they start a couple hours before. Dr. Spruill will be there with books, and Jen Lucas is the new director of alumni relations. She will be there hosting, and actually is a really great sign up already. Good turnout of people coming. So really excited about that.
Great.
I could Google it real quick.
We'll put it in our liner notes, but yeah, Rob can find it.
The first one looks like it's going to be at Regents Field in Ann Arbor. And the second one, or I don't know which the order is. Yeah, that's the first one. And the second one looks like it's going to be at Hopcat in East Lansing.
Okay.
Yep, that's right. I did know that one. So, yeah, and I think it's like, so far, you know, a lot of people signed up. Tech alum are not the greatest for signing up. They just kind of show up, but the sign up has been really good. So we're
guilty of that at alumni events for sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Yep.
Thanks very much.
That's great talking to you. I'm sure we'll have to do this again.
Yeah, happy holidays to you as well. Enjoy enjoy spending time with the family.
Yeah. Our condolences about your father as well. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks. And I'd be happy to do this again, you know, maybe in the summer or I don't know, sometime. Maybe
off-season chats are always good. We can talk about not actual on-ice stuff. They work well for that.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
I'm sure
most of us are going to try to be up for the 100-year alumni stuff too. So maybe we'll try to do something in person even.
Yeah, that'd be a good time. And maybe the locker room will be done and we could do a tour.
Nice.
Yeah, that'd be cool. That'd be good.
Yeah.
Do a podcast for the locker room. That would be exciting.
Do it on Fibke Dental at the way home.
Right. We're
hoping all the bids come in okay, and we'll see what happens, but we'll be doing some renos, so that might be a fun thing to do. So
yeah, that's exciting.
All right.
Good to hear.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you so much, Suzanne.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Wondering why the end of the conversation with Suzanne about the GLI kind of felt abrupt. It's because it's been cut up to remove the rest of our conversation and save it for next week, because we ended up chatting with her for about an hour and a half, and we weren't planning on recording next week at all. So instead of doing that, we've cut up this 2-hour and 20-minute podcast into two parts. So there might be a couple other times during this podcast where the breaks feel a little hard or confusing, but that's just because some of the content has been split between the two episodes. So hope you come back next week on December 30th and check out part 2 with our continued conversation with Suzanne. Let's talk about our road split weekend in Ann Arbor and East Lansing. The Bastard... Troll Holiday Classic.
That's and Suzanne was very like, you know, political about it, like very diplomatic about it, I guess I should say.
Yeah.
And it's a good word, yes.
I respect her a lot, and I understand that it's a big challenge how she has to do it, but this isn't the GLI. I do not think it should be called the GLI.
Yes, and absolutely. There's no disrespect to Suzanne or the athletic department. They did what they had to do to make sure the tournament survived and had some iteration this year, so people knew it wasn't death. But this is.
Well, it's also a big deal in terms of power and out of conference. And if we do manage,
by
to
the
sleep,
way, Rob,
I
hate that you call it power.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
you,
I do.
What do you want to hear? PWR?
Pairwise rankings.
Pairwise? It's not that hard.
Yeah. Pairwise. I can call it pairwise. I can try to change that.
Okay.
You know, the fact that it's a big pairwise deal, and you know, now they count as away games for us. So there's a little bit more, a little bit.
You got to win, but you have to win. In order for that to matter, you need to win.
The crappy part about this format is the regular GLI is set up for Michigan Tech to have a chance to beat Michigan and Western, which would be huge this year. You're basically beating two top five teams in pairwise.
That's
now,
true.
Yeah, it's also much Michigan, more difficult for that to happen.
Right, but Michigan State isn't awful in pairwise.
No, I'm not saying they are, but I'm saying you're losing out on the chance to beat two top five teams in the pairwise.
Yeah.
Get quality wins versus two teams in different conferences. The neutral stuff, that only comes in the quality win bonus, right? So I don't think that doesn't play into the rest of it, if I'm not mistaken. That's only the quality win bonus component.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Which doesn't really play into the Michigan State game at all. It's just Michigan at the moment, but that can change as things go on.
Where does the quality win bonus start? 16?
I think it's further than that. I think it's
right next to the two cliff.
Because Minnesota State or Michigan State is 18 in a pairwise, so I think that's a quality win bonus.
What was the old Tuck Cliff? Top 20?
20. Actually, 20.
Okay, then it should be 20 because it's about.
Yeah, so right now Michigan State is a quality win bonus.
Okay. So I guess it is then. It probably won't be much because it's basically ramps as you go up. Not that Michigan State can't go on a run and be higher at the end of the season.
Yeah, it's going to be a marginal. We got killed last week or two weeks ago because Clarkson fell out of quality win bonus area.
Okay, so they need to keep doing that. Yeah. And then we got hurt a little bit by Bowling Green's failure to finish either game.
Oh, what a rough set of games to watch the results come in.
To be up, be up 3-0 going into the third and losing regulation is terrible. In overtime, right?
Especially against Ohio State, that essentially makes Bowling Green a must-win series, and they're not a bad team, which is tough.
And then to miss a penalty shot with 20-some seconds left that would have tied the game and possibly force overtime again, that's tough. But to get to these non-conference games, I mean, we talked about it earlier. I'm definitely disappointed that it's not a real tournament, but in the same token, like all the off the ice stuff set aside, like I'm happy it's still happening. It's a good opportunity for Michigan Tech, who should be full strength, to go in and play a Michigan team that's missing how many players? Eight?
Five or seven, I believe it was.
Five U.S. players. Are they missing any players that are playing for Canada?
They're missing a couple players for Canada, I believe. Okay,
so it's like, I think it's eight. At least it's five Americans. I don't know how many non-Americans, but
Pairwise don't care. Pairwise don't care.
Nope, it doesn't, which is also why
Pairwise, my second favorite team. Let's go, baby.
Yeah, which is like, I can understand. I mean, screw him, but I can understand why Mel doesn't like playing this tournament, because every year his team is built to be missing a half dozen players for this thing. And that's his own choice in how he
recruits.
Don't
have a whole lot of sympathy.
No, I don't either. But you can understand why he doesn't really like it. I mean, it doesn't matter. How many times did Red go in and win the GLI missing five or six players for World Juniors? Now, granted, I think Mel has leaned on those types of players more so than Red ever did. And I think there's more pressure. Like, you don't see nearly as many major junior players for the U.S. team as you used to. It's a lot more college kids now.
I think that's because as a whole, college hockey is getting those players to commit.
No, like, I agree. Like those players are choosing Michigan and Minnesota and BC and BU over going to the Western Hockey League or Ontario now. the Bears just dropped touchdowns twice in a row, Dustin. How many points does that cost them you that they can't score?
I don't know. I'm screwed. I'm just completely screwed now.
All right. So what do we actually think is going to happen when the GLI happens, guys? or whatever
I'll, you want to call it. I'll go out on a limb and say the Michigan game is an overtime win. I think that that's just kind of the way of the land. I think that Yost is an intimidating environment as much as I will let everyone know that Yost is the most overrated building I've ever been in my life. If you want to see a poorly retrofitted field house that's just steel scaffolding, do I have the building for you. But, like, there's something to be said for the environment that's there, but I think that the Tech fans are going to bring it. But, like, because it's essentially a Michigan home game, and even though they're missing so many players, I think it still kind of, like, tilts the scale in their direction. But I think it ends up being an overtime win for Tech, and I think that Tech take cares of Michigan State in regulation.
Rob, what do you think is going to happen?
I think the only thing that's acceptable from us is a sweep. I think we need to after kind of what's happened with the St. Thomas stuff, and it's we need to go into this and win two games. If they want to be in contention for an at-large bid, it's a big deal to go down there and be successful in both those games. So I'm hoping we see a sweep. Whether we see it or not, I don't know if that's going to happen, but that's what needs to happen.
I think we do see a sweep, and I'm going to be optimistic here. And I don't know if it's necessarily optimistic as much as it's just looking at the facts. And the facts are Michigan is losing a ton of their top talent. There's no reason why we shouldn't beat Michigan when they're losing that much talent.
Yeah, I'm right.
That should be a win. And I just think we're better than Michigan State. Right? It's as simple as that. We're a better team than Michigan State. That should add up to two wins. I think it's two wins.
And as I think as much as Matt has said, and maybe it's more of a matter of like my thoughts on how well they feel it for traditional GLI, I can't imagine that this is going to be the most intimidating weekend to be playing these teams or a time of year. And not weekend, because it's not weekend days.
When we're talking about the Pep Bam piece, I honestly think you're going to see Tech fans grumpy and salty at the fact that the Pep Bam can't be there and make the atmosphere into one of their own. Because honestly, we're the only ones that travel for GLI anyways anymore, even though it's in the backyard of Michigan and State. They just don't care.
And that's another thing.
Take over their arenas and make them look embarrassing. And it's why I'm considering making the drive. You know, like
I would
laugh and I want to come.
Rob, tell you what, if I see you there, you got at least one beer on me. How about that?
I tried to buy Rob a beer
last weekend or this past weekend, and Rob just blew me off.
You need to give him a little more heads up than, hey, I'm at a bar in Appleton at 10 o'clock at night.
It wasn't 10 o'clock. That was six o'clock.
For me, it'll be like, hey, Rob, I'm going to make good on a promise I made to you. Let's like set up a time. So, like,
Matt, if they somehow go to overtime, no matter how many players Michigan's missing, I think Michigan wins, because I'm guessing they have three guys that can win a face-off and are faster than Michigan Tech, and we'll find a way to dig around.
I don't know. See, for me, like, I get so heavily invested.
For an overtime at the GLI? Is it going to be 3-on-3?
It's 3-on-3 than shootout, I believe.
No, there's no shootout because it's a non-conference game. There's no shootouts in non-conference. It's overtime, and if it finishes tied after the 5 minutes, it's a tie. And because it's not a tournament, there's not going to be a shootout to determine who advances, and there's not going to be sudden death overtime in a championship game.
Here's what I'm going to say. If we end up tying Michigan, I don't want to hear a single goddamn person in our Discord say a word, because that's what they want.
If it ends in a tie, I'm fine with it. That's how it should be.
I swear to God.
There's a difference between complaining that we shouldn't have lost it, like tied a game, we should have won it, and saying that tie, like, I understand that the losing winning overtime is basically a tie. My problem with all of that is, if that's the way you're going to do it, that's the way it should be in the standings, and you can't have the Eastern teams not doing the same thing as the Western teams. I can
hear some standardization problems with it. I'll listen to that argument, but that it's not fun, entertaining, garnering new fans, won't hear it. So if you can just imagine for a second, it's very easy for me to get wrapped up into the emotional side of hockey. So if you can just like wrap your mind around that concept for a moment.
The Dyna versus Duluth East, is that what we're talking about here?
essentially, I'm just kind of talking about how, like, if I it's very easily for me to get emotionally invested in a team that I went to school for, that I care about so much, that, like, it's just easy for me to just block out everything else. So with that, rivalry games just flip a switch in me as a fan, and I know it does a similar thing for the players. That's why. Okay, cool it.
Cool it. Where did that
come from? All right, while we're just imagining this world in which I can get wrapped up in being a fan, so that's why I think the Northern series is just a different beast than every other series. Like, you can just. And how we've talked about how much we both love that, and it frustrates us that we can't do the same thing against, like, Mankato and Bemidji. I think that's kind of a similar thing that we see, that we're going to see against Michigan, is that knowing the history of that series, walking into that building, knowing, like, this is the deal, is going to light something in the players. And
I hope so. It does help, but I also feel like
if it goes over time, maybe it creates some magic, you know?
Oh, maybe we got off the schneid, and we'll figure it out now. Maybe we'll be good in overtime now for a while.
I mean, we haven't seen enough evidence to say
maybe
that.
Maybe all the players listen to the podcast and are like, shoot, man, those guys are right.
Well, Suzanne listens to it. She listened to it last week.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that she listens. Now we got to, yeah. But, I mean, Matt, you're talking about the attitude. I mean, Rob, you picked a sweep. Dustin, you picked a sweep, right?
I picked a sweep.
Well,
I think Matt, you picked a tie and a win. That's different.
Yeah, yeah, that's a tie and a win. Yeah,
I picked a 55% win.
You're the pessimistic one of us now.
Yeah. Would you just imagine that for a half second?
Welcome to being old.
Can I give you a handshake, Dustin? This is great.
You are the pessimistic one, because the three of us are picking sweeps, and you picked a 1.55 win out of two for the weekend.
Oh no.
Yeah. No.
I don't know. It's just those games against Michigan are just always so different. And like,
my hope is
that's what I love and hate about them.
After what happened on Saturday at St. Thomas and how disappointing that result was, is that the guys are fired up. They know how important this series is to postseason and carrying forward with being perhaps an at-large bid if we get it. And we just go in there and steamroll a team that's missing a bunch of people, and then carry that into Michigan State the second night.
Could very well be.
Yeah, I have a hard time believing that if we can sweep this weekend, or this series, whatever you want to call it, and then not
this holiday extravaganza. Yeah,
sure. If we can somehow do that, and then not lay an egg against Ferris and St. Thomas when we play them on the road, and then play 500, a little 600 against the rest of the games we have. I don't see how you're not 12th pairwise.
The pairwise should stay decent. Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, yep. Exactly.
Especially if some of that is wins against Bemidji, Bowling Green, Minnesota State, and not just wins against Lake State, Northern, and
I'm happy Bowling Green's Carnival, because Carnival always brings a certain, you know, fire to the team, right? So it's good to be playing a decent team at Carnival to kind of help with that, you know, motivation level, right? That always seems to be decent.
And the other thing is the team's been pretty good on the road compared to at home, I think, this year.
Yeah, I believe you're correct there. Now, either way, it's this weekend is one of those weekends that's going to make a big difference, you know, postseason-wise, and whether they pull it off or not is going to say a lot about the team. So, you know, hopefully we do see us, you know, that sweep that we all want to see.
Yeah, I agree. Anything else we want to talk about, guys?
I got a lot to talk about, but none of it's relevant.
I've never been, and I've also never been to Yost and Munn. And I do, as much you say Yost is overrated, I do want to see those arenas.
It's worth a go once, but then you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. Like, it's cool. You walk in there and it's...
Imagine watching a hockey game inside of a dystopian aluminum can.
It's a very good summary.
Like, to me, part of that whole thing is getting down there as a Tech fan and basically tossing a middle finger to Michigan and Michigan State for doing what they've done this year and out cheering them in their own arena. Sounds like a really fun time to me.
There are basically two reasons to go to this event. One is to out cheer them in their own building, and two is to cross off two rinks in 1 week or in two days.
Exactly. Yeah. And I don't know if I'll have the chance to do that. No. Unfortunately, those 2 days, my brother has decided over that period, that's when he actually has to work. He's doing work on those 2 days and can't get out of it over break. So my normal road tripping friend is not here.
Yeah. And if I could, my problem is I think the games are when I don't even remember
Wednesday night and Thursday 5.
Okay. So like
I'm other more than willing to drive there on Wednesday and drive home after the game Thursday, if that works for your schedule, Tim.
Well, the problem is if I am in Appleton or Nina for the week for any days, then I'll have my daughter. So I'm not just going to leave her with Nana.
You'll only be gone one night.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, if you guys come, I'll buy a regular beer for Rob and a root beer for Tim because he's off the suds for now. And since this is pretty much only going to be stuff Nick's listening to, I really appreciate him a lot.
No, it's been nice having him.
Oh, yeah. It's been really good to have that outside perspective.
I am so happy that we basically got three new editors at the same time. So it never felt like anybody was overloaded. So we can, like, that's always what I've wanted, is to have enough people that if somebody's gone for a week, we can cover it, but nobody feels like they're doing too much. Like,
so now it feels like,
because the last time we added a new editor besides you, Matt, he got overloaded in like a week and quit.
If I got overloaded, I wouldn't tell you because I like it too much. it's been really nice for me because with Alex stepping down and me being able to step up, it really feels to me a lot more like, and I oversee the overall messaging and making sure that our bases are covered, that things read in a nice manner, that they're following a certain format. It feels like I'm doing a lot more of that than like, doing a lot more of like everyday.
Whereas before you came on, Alex was editing everything.
Yeah.
And and back then I was doing regular recruiting articles, and we had the column and the preview, and we had like the weekend wrap up. So there were like actually like four or five things a week for Alex to edit. Yeah. So I was actually helping edit too. And that's a lot. And that's why we tried to add editors back then, and somebody got overwhelmed because we tried to get him to do like two things a week, where it was really nice that right around the time Alex stepped down, I managed to convince three different people to join in. So we got a new writer, but also basically an editor, and then two other editors to come on so that everything's kind of shared instead of put on one person.
And I've really appreciated Sean because Mike's columns are pretty much like he misses like a comma or something somewhere sometimes, or he puts too many commas in because he's not used to APA.
Yeah.
But like, Sean's able to do that like 2 second thing, and I'm able to just push it out. Like, that's a really nice thing that's off my plate. Like, I love Mike's columns, but not having to read them in their entirety before published is a very nice thing off my plate. And then I can just focus on Zmaitis' series preview. And as good as he is at writing those, golly, that guy's English. That's a task in and of itself.
So haven't edited any of my shit in a long time.
Well, I actually didn't. Well, yeah, I remember I used to roast you a little bit, but
yeah, I've never been. Writing is not my
strong suit. I don't know. It's very cool to be in a position where people are consuming our content at a rate and people want to be involved in it enough where it's just it's very much a labor of love at this point.
No, and I mean, like, Nick is doing all that, and he has remained a patron.
Yeah,
at the $10 level, even though he's been getting all that as part of it, like, I appreciate that so much that he stuck by with his commitment. You know, basically between him and the Facebook post I did, we picked up the three guys. It's been great. I appreciate all the help. Now I just need to get back. Either I need to find somebody else that wants to do it, or I need to get back into like actually writing articles about the recruits and not just talking about them on here for 5 minutes
sending out a
tweet about it.
That's what, because I think the solution here truly is finding somebody who's willing to edit the podcast, because as like your bio says, your passion's recruiting. So I feel like having you being the writer for those pieces.
Well, that's okay. Cause it's
the best part.
I have no problem finding somebody else that wants to do the recruiting articles, honestly, because I'm getting old to be talking about kids born in 2005.
I mean, that's, oh shit, that's 9 years after I was born. So, man, I'm even starting to get up there. But yeah, I hear what you're saying.
So yeah, if anybody listening wants to learn some of the tricks of how I did stuff to write that stuff, that's fine. If I honestly don't have my daughter till like the 27th of December, I'm probably going to try and write articles, at least a two-parter, yeah, about the Alberta pipeline that has started here. Yeah. And then maybe speculate on the goalie and that kind of stuff.
No, you don't need to speculate. I already nailed it down.
Yeah.
We'll and see. One of my good buddies lives in Canton now, so maybe I can convince him to get development team season tickets.
Do you want me to reach out to my prospective goalie
and ask?
And ask, and just be like, hey.
I mean, honestly, the worst he says is no, right?
Right.
The worst he says is no, right?
Yeah. So he's like, yeah, he'll be like, I would never touch Michigan Tech with a 10-foot pole.
And then he'll commit the next day.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be funny. But yeah. Anyway.
Sorry, I've been blocking out the conversation for like the last 2 weeks. So
for the last 2 weeks? But yeah, we haven't been talking for 2 weeks, Dustin.
It has seemed like it.
Fantasy challenge. Nothing happened. Everyone's in the same place. All right. That's it.
Yes. No, we can give an update on a fantasy challenge.
No, because we gave the update last week.
The update last week said that we were going to do a holiday tournament, and we're not going to
We already gave it. Like, yeah, screw that. We're getting back in January. We gave.
Well, I don't know. Was that going to get cut? I don't know that. I don't know if that's cut content or not.
There's nothing wrong with Dustin saying it twice, so I can have it in both episodes.
Right. So we're not going to do. We're not going to do the fantasy challenge this week because I feel like we're in the time of a lot of uncertainty of whether or not games are going to get played and tournaments are going to happen and whatnot.
I don't want to hear that, but it makes sense.
It's just tough. I hope GLI happens, but it's just like even in the stupid format, like hearing all the stuff that's going on with the NHL right now, how like there might be an announcement as soon as tomorrow that they're going to shut down for the rest of the year and start up on the first or something. But like, it's just.
Yeah, I figured just for the fantasy challenge, it's easier to just see what it's like in early January and try to fire it back up for the second half.
Yeah, and as somebody that works with air quotes in the medical industry, like I work for a medical company updating websites, it's hard not to get doomer about this kind of stuff, especially with seeing how sports are going.
Yeah. It could be a very interesting second half to the season, which is sad because I don't really want to deal with that. I don't want to be the head in the sand type guy, but that's kind of where I'm at with this. Like it's
tough.
I've done my vaccinations. I wear my mask when I go out and do stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm trying not to let the other people doing their own thing bother me. So
I know. And I guess I know as much as we're not a political thing, like I don't even know why medical information at this point is political, but please, please get vaccinated. Like, you can disagree with the semantics, the politics of it as much as you want, but it's going to greatly reduce your possibility of getting severely sick, and it's going to help the people around you. And as much as it's just kind of become a deal, like COVID is just going to be part of our lives forever. And it's not going to become another illness. Like the goal at this point is to make it another illness on the same caliber as the flu. And it's not going to get there unless everyone does their part.
Yep.
1 minute remaining in the podcast.
That should do it for this episode of the Chasing McNaughton podcast. Please check out our Patreon and join by visiting patreon.com/tech hockey guide. Patrons that are black level or above receive an authentic MTU jersey patch, which you'll probably get in 2026 based on supply chain issues. Speaking of supply chain issues, did you guys hear the shit about the jersey order?
Oh no, what's going on? That's actually a good thing.
Do you want to stop the recording before I talk about that?
This should be public podcast, I think.
Exclusive Pro claims that they have three less jerseys than I have nameplates that need to be made. and University Images has already sold all of their stock. So I either have to figure out what the issue is and if my list has three more names than it should because those people never paid University Images, or pick three people at random that don't get to have jerseys and give them their money back.
That sucks.
Yeah. So I'm never ordering in conjunction with University Images ever again. That'll probably get cut. But anyway.
Leave it for the patrons.
We'll leave it for the patrons. That's fine. Because no. Suzanne isn't a patron.
I don't think anything you said there would be upsetting to Suzanne anyways. So.
I don't know.
I think Suzanne would understand.
Yeah.
I think she
gets it. I will be like, okay, how many jerseys is too many jerseys to not deal with them? And I will cap the order at that in the future. That's I'm going to do.
Good call.
Black level or above also gets you access to extra podcast content, including extended versions of most episodes. Since some episodes we do full versions just because I can't figure out what to cut, which is what's going to happen with most of this one, I think. Patrons at the white level or above get access to our Zoom chats featuring guests like John Scott, Joe Sean, Brad Patterson, and Cam Ellsworth, which by the time this episode is out will have happened. That is actually tomorrow night. Follow us on... Yeah, tomorrow night we're having Cam Ellsworth. 8 o'clock, Central.
Oh, I wonder if he's still mad at me.
About what? I don't know if he'll be about what this time, Dustin? Asking him why he's not head coach at Michigan Tech yet, or what?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
oh, yeah. Follow us on Twitter at ChasingMacPod or at Tech Hockey Guide. You can submit questions... Well, whatever. Nobody ever does that. You can submit questions to our Patreon page, our Facebook page, or on Twitter whenever we ask for questions. We pretty much record at 8 p.m. Central every Monday. So if you've got a question, go ahead and just ask us. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcast. If you can't find the podcast on your site of choice, please let us know and we'll make it happen. The more you rate, review, and share, the more people we can reach. So tell your friends. We're going to try something new this year. If you give us a 5-star rating, which apparently is specific to Apple Podcasts, Dustin will read the review. You leave no matter what it says. So let's get some ratings and see what you have to say. Once again, thanks to our sponsor, Fibke Dental in Rhinelander, Wisconsin. And as always, special thanks to Mitch Lake for recording our introduction and our patron saint, Doc McResin, for his generous donation to get this thing running. We hope you enjoy. Finally, thanks to the thank you notes for all the bumpers in this week's episode. I know you broke up like a decade ago, but you gave me access to your music for free, so we use it.
Been listening to the Chasing McNaughton podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA.